Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Carlos, and thank you for tuning in to Peauxetic Expressions. Last week, I reviewed Teyana Taylor's highly anticipated new CD, KTSE, which now she's planning on re-releasing that album with some of the deleted verses and I think a couple of songs even that didn't make it on this first go-around. So this weekend, I looked for it, didn't see it, but who knows, maybe it'll actually come out. But there's no denying that during the month of June, there were some pretty big music releases from some major artists. We had Beyonce and Jay-Z, Nas, and of course, Drake's CD, Scorpion, which just dropped this past Friday. So a lot of people were really hyping up this album because, you know, of course, the Pusha T and Drake beef, where Pusha T basically outed Drake and told the world that Drake has a son that he does not claim. Now this comes after Drake mentioned Pusha T's fiance in the first part of the rap beef that he did. So with that, Drake really had a lot to prove, I think, with this CD. And people, his biggest fans, I think, were really expecting to buy it. So there's no surprise, or buy the streaming, I should say. There's no surprise that it's gonna be a successful album. But with just these first couple of days in the sales, he's already broken the first day streaming records for Apple Music and Spotify, which were previously set earlier this year by Post Malone's latest CD. And by the time it's all said and done, by the end of his first sales week, they're saying that Drake Scorpion could have the biggest streaming week ever. So not just of 2018, but this could be the biggest streaming week of all time. So with that in mind, this is Drake's first double CD. So his CD Views had about 20 tracks, which that technically, track-wise, could have counted as a double CD. But with this one, I will say he legitimately had a good reason to make it two separate discs, because the first part of it really is more so his rap side that a lot of the diehard, I would say, early Drake fans may appreciate a little bit more. The second CD has more of his melodic, kind of sing-songy flow, if you will. So the CD is a little bit divided that way. Now, it came just at the same time as Billboard changed up their tally and how they count music sales. So now, free services that offer streams will be counted less. So in the past, basically, any way that you could stream a CD, whether it was Spotify, Tidal, Apple Music, Google Play, wherever, that along with free streams were without subscriptions were counted the same or equally. Now there's a heavier weight on these paid subscription services. So with that in mind, and these numbers that Drake has already, he's setting to just really blow the doors off of everyone's expectations for his first album, for his first week's sales of this album. So he's pretty much a shoe-in for the number one album in the country. Don't really think that's really surprising. The biggest surprise here, though, is some of the lyrics in particular that he mentions about his son on the song March 14th, which is actually not his son's due date, as was previously speculated, or his actual birthday. His son was born on October 11th. So there's no word or no confirmation that I've heard of what that date actually means. But he does say in the song that he only met his son one time. Yes, he's only met him one time, just like the song says. So I think that's interesting, because now we have, you know, in the wake of this, you know, the Me Too movement, which I know that's something that's different. It's totally different, but it is very serious. I think that had Drake released an album and he wasn't in his heyday and he admitted something like that, I don't think as many people would stand by him. I think that's pretty serious, but I think honestly, because he is so popular right now, it's going to really kind of go under the radar as far as how people feel about this album. When the allegations about R. Kelly came out, which again is a little bit of a different situation, or a lot of it, I should say. I think that people are not willing to stand by him now because he's out of his heyday. If that came out when I Believe I Can Fly was hot and popping, I really don't think a lot of people would have boycotted his music the way they do today. That's just my opinion. But stepping out that soapbox and getting back to the album, Some of my favorite tracks on it are Emotionless, where he samples Mariah Carey's early 90s hit, Emotions. Nice for What, love that song. That's one of the best ones on the album, where he has that kind of Louisiana bounce feel to it, where he samples Lauryn Hill's X Factor. And there's a couple of other songs on the album too that also borrow some of that Louisiana bounce style. The biggest surprise though, I would say, is not the content of the album. I mean, he's pretty much, for the most part, Drake is emotional. He's talking about women he's hurt in the past. Of course, I think people expected him to address something about his son, even though he did go into more detail than I expected. But the biggest surprise of the album was him having Michael Jackson featured on this album. So there's some unreleased music or an unreleased part of a track that's included on Scorpion on one of the songs. And judging on some of the speculation around when that song came out, it looks like it was maybe recorded in the early 80s, which was, you know, Michael Jackson's, you know, really big heyday. And also, there's a song that features the late Static Major. So I thought that was hilarious because a lot of Drake's fans are millennials. You know, a lot of these people are under 30 years old. And if you're younger than 30, chances are you probably don't even know who Static Major is. But he wrote a lot of Aaliyah's later hits, the ones like right before she passed away. And he was in the R&B group Player, who had a couple of hits of their own too. So of the two albums or of the two discs, I would say that the first one is probably more my favorite, the one where he's doing more of the rapping. The second one is really great too, but there's a couple of songs that I could do without, like Jaded and Finesse, those two songs. It's just a little bit too much singing. And his voice is always a little bit off key. So to hear that drug out for a whole song is just a bit much. But some of the other songs, like I said, the one with Michael Jackson is great. The one with Static, After Dark, is great. I love March 14th about his son, which is also on the second CD. So that one is more serious, I would say. But out of the two, I do enjoy the first one better because I feel like I can just listen to it, you know, the whole way through. In terms of his production and who he worked with, pretty much the same people for the most part. He has Future appearing on here. There's also a local Louisiana duo that he worked with on this album that was new. He hadn't worked with previously before. There's Party Next Door on here. 40, who's usually the executive producer for all of his albums, is also featured. But this time he does work with 3-6 Mafia's DJ Paul on his Jay-Z duet that he has on the album. And interestingly enough, supposedly DJ Paul and Drake's dad are close friends. So, hey, who would have thought of that? But another thing I saw on his site, or more so on his Instagram page, is the selling of these Scorpion jackets. So, of course, you know, this marketing and this new age of music, this, you know, evolved age of music, I should say, is really funny to me sometimes because he's selling these jackets and, you know, they're cool looking jackets, you know, nylon material, I guess, or whatever. And they're not like leather jackets or anything. But on the back of them, they say Scorpion, and then it has like his album information, his name on there. And on the front chest, it's like the left side, I believe, you can get your name on the jacket. So it'll say Scorpion, executive produced by, and it can have your name. I didn't executive produce this album. Why would I want my name on? I don't get it. But some people that are diehard Drake fans will pay for the jacket. I don't know how much it costs. I didn't even look. I know it's probably some astronomical price that people are more than willing to pay, judging by some of his Instagram posts of people that have already purchased the jacket. But I will say my expectations for this album were honestly quite low. The reason for that is because I am a Drake fan. I wouldn't say I'm just a super diehard Drake fan, but his albums are kind of hit or miss to me. He has this pattern that he's been building up for quite some time now, where I think he puts out a solid album and then one that's not so great. So case in point, if you're reading this, it's too late. I thought it was a great album, or technically mixtape. V Views, not so much. That CD is just depressing to me. I put it on, I tried to get through it, I've listened to it a few times, but it's just too much this emo whining. I just can't do it. More Life, he redeemed himself. I love More Life. I actually still listen to a lot of those tracks. So when he came back with Scorpion, I mean, I was like, wow, okay, this is really a solid album. Honestly, it's probably my favorite album as a whole of his since Take Care. And that's been, like 5 years ago, I think, the CD came out. But curious to know what your all's thoughts are on Scorpion. So make sure you check out the review and leave your comments, rate, subscribe. And as always, thank you for watching.